Hey guys, welcome to yet another episode of Suits and Sports. And joining us today, we have another special guest. It's Mr. Advocate Parth Goswami. So Parth sir here is actually the member of the screening panel, World Athletics. He's an advocate, Supreme Court of India, and he's a legal head at the chambers of Parth Goswami. So thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invite. How are you, sir?
Thank you so much for having me, Ryan. I'm very well. How is Sunday going for you?
I think Euros.
You know, how is this going, sir? But we are really sorry to see that you are sitting in a law firm, in your firm. It means like you are Sunday, you are working on Sunday.
No, it is a like very chilled out Sunday, Shubhrajit. It's a very chilled out Sunday. Just reading some files and spending some time before I start watching European Cup match in the evening. So it's a very chilled out Sunday. I'm not working.
I think in regard with, just because the Euros have started, we have to like, you know, put in a little extra effort on off days to compensate for the amount of time we will be spending otherwise. Putting that aside, so my first question to you, sir, is very informal. So I think we all know that you were a good, I mean, you obviously were a very prominent athlete back then. So could you give us an insight as to how it was playing sports in your college days and stuff?
So Ryan, I have always been very enthusiastic about sports. During my school days, I was the captain of the athletics team and I played basketball also. And since I have a family of sports persons who have won medals at national and international level, so sports run in my blood. So I pursued sports even after my schooling and played professionally for a good 4 years. So I was a middle distance runner. And I have won a lot of medals at state championships and I've played many nationals at junior and senior level. In 800 meter, middle distance running was my forte.
So, Pastor, the question is like, it's not a question. Like, we want to know one thing, that you were a national champion, played for 7 times, you went for under 17, the league, like national team. So, is that make you inspired to go for a sports law? How you came for a lawyer?
So it is a very interesting story. I did not plan to become a lawyer at all. So when I was studying my graduation in commerce, I was pursuing sports full time. And as an athlete, you require a college and institute to represent during your sports career. Once I finished my graduation in commerce from Delhi University, Delhi College of Arts and Commerce, I was wondering what to do next. And there were options for me to pursue studies in sports, or there was a friend of mine who was a senior during sports days. He had joined law faculty in Delhi University. So I followed him there and he was the one who forced me to join him there, and so that we could continue playing sports from the Delhi University Faculty of Law. So it so happened that my friend was already there, so I joined that law faculty. There was no intention to become a lawyer initially, at least. I just wanted to pursue my career in sports and play for a college.
So sir, how this happened? Like, you are now in of the screening panel in World Athletics. So how you moved to that way? Like, you had just followed a serious tape. Then suddenly, how you move? Like, you are now ahead. I will like, obviously, the senior will be also happy with you. You are now ahead of your senior. Suddenly, you are now one of the world reputed organizations. So how that happened?
So after graduating from Faculty of Law, I joined Commonwealth Games Organizing Committee as in-house legal consultant. It was a wonderful experience working there as an in-house legal consultant. We saw first-hand experience of how big contracts are drafted, how the multi-sporting games are conducted, managed. It was a wonderful experience back then. Although the Commonwealth Games was surrounded by a lot of controversies, but according to me, it was a very well-organized games and we had a lot of fun working with the legal department there. It was a first-hand experience of seeing how a game of a magnitude of Commonwealth Games was organized in India. It was great experience back then. And moving forward, when I started practicing after Commonwealth Games, there was a couple of athletes who were very dear friend of mine, and they were found in the center of all the doping controversy after Commonwealth Games 2010-2011 controversy. There were a lot of athletes which were found positive for a stimulant MHA back then. Two of them happened to be very close friend of mine. So it so happened that I got an opportunity to represent them before National Anti-Doping Agency, and I never looked back after that.
That's the turning point of your story, that like you have become one of the world famous, like India and world famous doping lawyer, right? So that is the start.
It's nothing like that, Shubhrajit. It's long way to go. I'm just doing my bit. Sports is passion, and representing athletes is, I feel it is a duty to represent them and save their career sometimes. So it's I do it like a duty for my sports fraternity members. That's about it. It's still a long way to go. I'm nowhere. I've reached nowhere yet.
So, sir, one thing I want to know from, like, you are dealing with so many doping cases, right? So many. So, what do you think, like, what is the, like, basic wrong in the route which our athletes do? Like, we know most of the athletes are not that much, is not coming from a, they're coming from a genuine, normal background, right? Like, if you say in UK and all, they have a basic studies and all, they know which website to search, which is the sampling things, and they know this thing. But India also, what is the problem in India? Sometimes, like, we feel like, is that like the, from the background where they're coming from, is that the problem of doping in India?
It is a very interesting question, Shubhrajit. Over the last 9 or 10 years since I've been practicing before National Anti-Doping Agency and other authorities who adjudicate anti-doping cases, what I have learned is the problem in India is lack of education. It is one of the basic problem due to which athletes get caught and have nowhere to go after that, because the rules, anti-doping rules, are so strict. It has the principles of strict liability, and it is, the burden is on the athlete to prove himself innocent rather than the agency proving him guilty. So it's the other way around, like how the principle of strict liability works. So coming back to your question, I feel that as an athlete also during those times, I felt that there was a major lack of education in athletes and as well as in coaches in dealing with the food supplements and the prohibited substances. There was obviously a urge in the athletes to perform better, because most of the athletes, I'm not talking about sport like cricket, but other sports, come from a very humble background and they want to achieve results so quickly and to get at least a government job. So the pressure is so much on them. So they would indulge in whatever they are advised, be it from their coaches, be it from their fellow team members, or be it from a basic supplement supplier who doesn't even know what it is. So if they are given an assurance that if you consume a particular thing, you will perform better, they are ready to go for it. And most of the times they do not even know what are the consequences. I have come across athletes who had no idea that anything like anti-doping even existed. So it is fundamentally so wrong with the sports that athletes consume these things and they do not even know that they will be tested and their career could be jeopardized. So that is a very major problem here.
Wow, so actually it was good getting that from your end, because like listening to it from a professional, you know, professional in regard with doping. So in that same regard, I want to ask you a question. So what is the procedure like, sir? So now let's say I'm an athlete and I just tested positive. So what's the procedure like? What happens after that?
So once an athlete is, athlete sample is collected, it could be collected in competition or out of competition, depending on whether he is in registered tested pool or not. So once you are found positive in a lab test, a notice of adverse analytical finding is sent to an athlete, which tells the athlete what substance has been found in his sample, whether it is a specified substance or a non-specified substance. So if in case of specified substance, there is still a possibility of optional provisional suspension, and athlete can still continue to play until his case is decided. However, in the case of non-specified substances, which are mostly anabolic steroids, the athlete is given immediate suspension. So from the date of sending the notice, athlete is suspended and cannot play. Thereafter, what happens is an athlete is required to give his explanation to the panel. His written explanation as to how a substance has entered his body, whether there was an intent, whether there was this negligence or fault in his behavior. Based on those explanations, athlete's case is put before a national anti-doping panel, which consists of a legal expert, a medical expert, and an ex-sports person. So these three people constitute a panel. They will hear the athlete. Athlete was given sufficient opportunity to bring forward his case, plead lack of intention, plead there was no fault or negligence on his part. And after analyzing and hearing the arguments, the panel is left to decide what will be the fate of the athlete, whether what would be the amount of ban he would get.
Sir, I want to ask you one thing. What do you think, like, the procedure of this sampling? Right, I have a question on that. Like, sampling A and B, you are taking one person to taking from one place to another. So, sir, for example, let's say, like, me, Ryan, and you are the computer, right? And somewhere we are in same level. Now we three have to go for the sampling. Now sometimes I feel like this question comes to me, my mind many times, sir. So what happened, like, in between there is a person who is taking our sample to one place to another, and maybe in certain place I have some power with me and I know who to talk with, who to give money, and all. Suddenly I am in your sample and Ryan's sample. This can happen, right? I am putting some of the ingredients, mixing with you, like I am putting, giving the money, bribing that person who is taking for you to there, because I know. So I am giving it sample and mixing it, then suddenly, obviously, at the end of the day, when it go to lab, they will find it, the sample will be in your blood, right? So what do you think, like, the procedure of this organization itself, it's prominent, strong, or like even this type of bribery thing can also be happened? Even we see in some many movies, like in the lab, they are changing the sample from the fridge. Do these things of thing really happen in real life, or there is any chance?
So it's a very controversial question, but I will still try to answer this. It's a very controversial, I tell you. Back in the days when there was no National Anti-Doping Agency, it was the National Sports Federation of each sport who would carry out the dope testing, sample collection, and even testing, and even the adjudication procedure. Say in the case of athletics, Athletic Federation of India would do it. In case of football, All India Football Federation would do it. This was pre-NADA times, before 2008. I have heard a lot of stories. I am not party to it ever, but I've heard a lot of stories that back then the sample collection officers were, like you said, bribed or were manipulated, and a person other than whose sample was to be collected would give the sample. So if, for example, Shubhrajit's sample is to be collected and Shubhrajit thinks that he has consumed something and he will get caught, he would request his friend Ryan to be inside the washroom and he would fill the container for the sample collection person. And technically, Shubhrajit's sample has been collected, but the sample which has gone to lab for testing was Ryan's. So the sample would definitely result in a negative finding and Shubhrajit is let off. So those were the pre-NADA days. But coming back to your question, over the years, a lot of things have improved. It is very difficult to manipulate now. It's almost impossible because the containers in which samples are collected are duly sealed in the presence of an athlete. And once sealed, it is only opened in the laboratory. And the laboratory, during the opening of the sample, records that the seal was intact. So once the container is sealed and it's sent to the laboratory, it's difficult. I mean, seals cannot be broken, but to say that manipulation can or cannot happen, it's difficult to say. Anything is possible. The cheaters are always one step ahead of the law enforcing agencies. They're always one step ahead.
And sir, have you went to any this type of stories, like where coach's son and his student are in competition, and now coach has used something to his student's food which was not in the knowledge of the student also. Then when the sampling was going on, the student got put it in the sample, whereas his son got selected because he was not. Have you went this type of story also?
You are absolutely bang on the point now, Shubhraji. These type of stories are extremely common in the doping arena. Whenever an athlete is caught, I mean, there are a number of athletes who will narrate these kind of stories to me. And I have seen firsthand, there was this case of an ace javelin thrower who is part of a national team now. He used to train in his village with a bamboo javelin. He was such a raw talent that he was unbeatable. He became unbeatable because of his talent. And when he was selected to represent India in junior level international competition, he was called by another coach of the same state to train with him before going to the international competition. It so happened that the coach's personal athlete was number two in India, and this raw guy was number one. And then when the sample was collected, this guy was tested positive. And when we wanted to see what evidence he had to prove that some foul play has been done by this coach who called him just before the competition and offered training to him, we saw that there was lot of newspaper cuttings with the pictures of this athlete and coach and the other athlete who was the personal trainer of personal athlete of this coach. In those newspaper cuttings, interestingly, although this athlete who came from the village stood first, the photograph of the other athlete who stood second was always there. And the coach would always talk good about the athlete who came second and not the one who came first. So this was presented before an ADA panel back in 2017, I remember, and the panel thought that it was some kind of unfair treatment given to this athlete by this coach, and which was very interesting because just 1 month before the competition, he offered him to come to him and train. And this athlete got benefit out of that case, and he is one of the top javelin throwers in India right now, without taking the names.
Actually, that's beautiful to hear from a sports law perspective. It's actually a beautiful instance. Like it proves that yes, there are people to fight for you. So once again, in the same regard, I want to ask you, so do these doping tests have validity? Like, let's say I tested negative today, there is a very good possibility that a person can consume something the next day and once again go and get something, right?
So Ryan, mostly an athlete is tested in competition when his competition is over. It's not that before he competes. So most of the times, once the competition is over, then only the sample is collected. Okay. So therefore there is no reason for them to collect it prior to the competition and let the athlete consume something performance enhancing and then compete. So it's mostly after the competition which it is collected.
So, and in India, is it like it happens after every sporting event? It's there. There is like a doping test that's compulsory for all athletes.
So, the national sports federations in India are required to inform National Anti-Doping Agency about their competitions. They have to provide National Anti-Doping Agency even with the state championship calendar these days, which we have observed that National Anti-Doping Agency has increased its testing over the years. So it is one of a very good things which National Anti-Doping Agency has done, because only if you increase the testing, and the more number of cheats will be caught. I'm sorry. So over the years, testing has increased, and therefore there is a rising levels of cases, the positive cases in India now.
Sir, in this regard, I have one question which is like very, because I want to know this question. Because see, for example, IPL. Let's take IPL as an example. So it's a private organization body, and even we know like we were like in after each match they have after they have a party. Right? After match they go for party and where they're consuming alcohol and all things. And so sir, do even for this cricketers like for this IPL time, do they also go for this nada test and all? Do you think like because you know like parties and all, even after before a match, one night before a match they're going for party. So what's your view in that?
So back in 2019, the BCCI eventually agreed to come under the purview of NADA. It was a long battle NADA had fought, and eventually BCCI had agreed that they will allow NADA to collect samples and to complete the adjudication proceedings. However, when it comes to IPL, it is a completely private tournament. Although it is BCCI is a stakeholder, but it is all it's a private competition, and they can devise their own rules for anti-doping also. I'll give you a very interesting example of the question you have asked. There is one of the sporting leagues happening in India, and they have framed rules for anti-doping for that league. The rules are so framed that an athlete, if caught during that period of the league, will be suspended only for 3 months. So they do not adhere with the WADA rules. So the rule is that maximum 3 months of suspension. Say, for example, an athlete, what happens, consumes a performance-enhancing drugs during a final match, which is the most important match. It is a team competition. Athlete consumes a performance-enhancing drug, and then he is caught later after the match. Tournament is over, everything is over, prizes are given, everyone has watched it on TV. And after a week or so, the result of one of the athletes comes positive. So at best, as per those rules, he could be suspended for 3 months. And as we all know, these leagues happen on yearly basis. So before the next year league starts, he is scot-free and he can participate again. So this is the kind of loophole which are there, which national federations should consider, and these rules should be consistent with the rules of National Anti-Doping Agency and World Anti-Doping Agency. Otherwise, it serves no purpose.
The reason of this question came in my mind because even if we follow certain sports person like cricketers, we follow them, so not in India, I'm taking different countries. We have, if we see their Instagram profile and all, we have seen them having cannabis and all, right? And we know the herbal cannabis are like, I'm not taking anyone's name. And also, if you are smart enough, like we all are smart enough, you can understand whom we're talking about. So they are having cannabis and even they're posting their stories, having a big round of cannabis and all. So that's the reason this thing came in my mind, even they are playing something cricket and all. And I have not heard anyone in cricket is going have been caught in the sampling. Mostly we'll hear like athletes or the footballers have gone went through or the lawn tennis players, except cricket. So that is the question. So is really cricket a gentleman there? So that is the reason it's came in my mind.
I don't know if I can answer that question. Even Ryan's eyebrows were raised when you asked that question. I saw a look on his face right now. So I cannot say which cricketer is consuming what. I am absolutely not aware of that. However, cricketers are now being tested, and there have been 3 or 4 instances where they have been caught using tributyline, say, for example, and they were banned for a couple of months. Those type of cases have been there. But when it comes to recreational drugs, which you are talking about, I am not aware if there is any such case yet. There is none, in my knowledge.
Excellent.
So again, a different question. So I'm actually taking our focus away from cricket. So in the NBA, sir, if you know the National Basketball Association, what happens there is anytime, let's say there's an average player, all right? If he performs, let's say he doesn't perform extremely well, even if he does an extraordinary dunk during the match, he's caught and dope tested right after that game. Especially, like, usually all of them are not tested. This guy is particularly tested just because he performed well. So do you think that is a, like, in terms of player dignity, is it a right thing to do, sir?
I do not know about the procedures the NBA follows while testing their players. However, in India, which I know for a fact that there is a plan created in the NADA office before going for a competition. Say, for example, I talk about athletics. A NADA officer will create a plan and come to the competition site, and he would not know who to test. He would only have a plan which would tell him which event in athletics and which position in that event they will test. Say, for example, the plan could include first and second position in 100 meter race, first and third position in short put race. So this is a plan which is randomly created and does not name any player at all. So like you said, it can be an unfair treatment to the player in case such testing is done, the target testing is done. But sometimes the random dope testing is done out of competition where on information NADA conducts such tests. So I'm aware of certain cases where on information a raid has been conducted or a test sample has been collected. So there are instances. But as far as in competition is conducted, the athletes are not tested by name. It's through by their position.
So I have another question. So this is again, I think it's in regard with law schools. I think we're moving slightly off the topic of doping. So Pritsit, sir, do you have any final question in regard with doping?
No, I don't have, still I don't have anything. Like, but yeah, the final question, we should, like, thank you. So sir, what's your view regarding this, our new doping policy? And like the recently, WADA came out with a new doping policy, right? What's your view in that?
So WADA has come up with the 2021 WADA code, which has replaced old WADA 2015 code now. So almost after 6 years, they have come up with a new code. The provisions more or less remains the same, but over the years, the rules have become tighter and stricter, and there is a very narrow margin for an athlete, a dope cheat, to come scot-free from these rules. The rules have become so stringent over the years that there is very little chance for a person who intends to cheat and consumes prohibited substance will be let off through these rules. So it's difficult. So doping in sports, it's not encouraged at all. It is unhealthy. It is unfair for sports. And it should not be done at any level. Although I represent athletes who get caught, but I would never support doping in sports because it's unfair for the other clean athletes. It's very unfair.
Definitely, sir. So another, like I said, a different question, sir. So you've played sports at a high level, and at the same time you're a successful lawyer. So once again, do you think, so I have a lot of batchmates of mine in law school who've literally stopped playing sports. They're like, because they want to focus in law school, and at the same time there are a few who are playing sports and stuff. So do you think it's like, considering what sports has to offer to overall development to a person in their character, do you think one should stop playing sports at any point of time because of law school or education?
I do not think that one should ever stop playing sports. Like you said, it has a vital role in overall personality development. Sports ensures good health and discipline. So one should play sports throughout his life. I am a big fan of football. I watch football and I play football whenever I get chance. As I told you, I was an athlete. I used to run and I still run whenever I get chance. So I should never stop playing sports, be it in law school or post law school, wherever you, I know a lot of high court judges, Supreme Court judges who make sure that they play badminton or they go for a run or they play whatever sports they like. One should never stop. Even despite their busy and hectic schedules, most stressful life, they ensure that they play sports. And this is one how one should be.
So you said you love football as well. So once another question, who are you rooting for this Euros and why?
I've always rooted for Germany since my childhood days. And I have no reason for rooting for them, but it so happened that I started liking Germany from very younger days and it has continued till now. I don't know whether this loyalty will ever change, but for now, Germany. I do not think they will do that well this time with this young team, but I hope they go far.
Is Mario Götze a hero for you?
So, sir, but one thing people are forgetting. From today itself, Copa America is also starting. But people are concentrating in the European parts of the world. Like, so those who are football fans, they know also Copa America started. So what's your bet in Copa America? Because previous Copa, I was a little disappointed at the final phase, Argentina won. So what's your view in that?
I'm a big Neymar fan and I love the way he plays and his skills. So I will root for Brazil this time. I hope they win.
You are in one side Germany and one side Brazil. So one side, so in World Cup, whom you support? Brazil or Germany?
Germany.
And then since you are Germany in better position. Then you are in better position because this, hopefully you remember the 7-1 scenario.
So when Germany and Brazil are playing like they did in 2016 World Cup semi-final, it was Germany for me, and it was a very satisfying night when Germany won 7-1 against Brazil. So, but when Germany is not playing in Copa America, yes, Brazil can go ahead and win. I have no difficulty.
I think your collar is almost the German flag, or is it black? Am I seeing it wrong?
It's not a German flag.
I'm saying it's almost.
It's a France flag. You can see it there. It's the flag of France.
And France are definitely hot favorites to win this European Cup this time.
So,
who are you supporting, Subhrajit and Ryan? Who are you supporting in the European Cup?
So, you tell first.
So, for me, Germany, always. Even if you come to my home only, you can find now this time the Germany flag is waving out from my balcony. So you will definitely know. My area is full Brazilian fan, but this is the only how you will find who is a German guy sitting here.
Do you get hostile treatment from your neighbors and your friends?
Sir, from my family itself, my father is a Brazilian supporter. So I still remember he was when the second goal happened, my father was saying, "Hey, this is something. This is a recap of some goal." I know. Watch at the corner, it's already second goal. So he was also in shock. Yeah, that time I was in my house when Germany was scoring one after another. And my family was, and all of the members, like all the uncles, and they were like, close the TV. Why should I close the TV? Why should I switch off the TV? Because, of course, my team is winning. So you guys can go and sleep. But I will watch full game. So that was something. Yeah, sometimes I feel hostile situation, but you know, when you are hero in that place, so it's something like, you know, in Bollywood type of hero. So it goes like that.
What about you, Ryan?
It's Portugal because I've been a Ronaldo fan since I was small. I used to be a Man U fan, and I think Ronaldo's goal against when David James was goalkeeping, he had a free kick goal. Since then, it's Ronaldo. And my dad used to be a Luis Figo fan, so it's been Portugal. So, yeah.
Great choice. Ronaldo is definitely an amazing player. And it's incredible to see, even at this age, he's continuing to play better than much younger players.
Sir, Parcel, something very wrong question to ask this generation, okay? Because for them, if Cristiano goes for France, they will support France. If Cristiano goes for England, they will support England. They don't know about their teams. Right, they are only for the one singular player. So no, don't ask this generation questions. They don't know what was the real football. They haven't seen the original football, I think so.
No, I'm sure that Ryan's decision to support Portugal is well reasoned one, and it's not based on this one.
Honestly, Portugal's team is really good this time. If you look collectively, if they could win 2016 with a less experienced team, their team today is, I think, considerably. I think this is Ronaldo's best chance to win the World Cup also next year. So, fingers crossed.
Yeah,
So since I'm a Liverpool fan and Portugal has Diego Jota in their team, I have a soft corner for Portugal as well.
No worries. So before we close our this session, this episode with you, so what's your final conclusion for the upbringing lawyers?
In terms of sports law, you mean, Subrajit?
Yeah, in terms of sports law, sir.
In terms of sports law, the opportunities are vast. Anti-doping is still a territory which has not been exploited as much as it should have been. And there are a lot of opportunities in anti-doping scenario and anti-doping cases in India, and it has not been exploited to its full potential. There is a lot of scope. People, the lawyer, law students who are sports enthusiasts should definitely explore this. There is definitely a lot of scope in this.
Great, sir. So once again, sir, on behalf of Global Sports Policy Review, a big thank you, sir, for taking time of your busy schedule and spending it with us and giving in your valuable points in regard with doping. It was indeed an experience listening to it from you, because you've actually dealt with it, you know, in front of your eyes. You've dealt with cases in regard with doping, and it was a really fruitful conversation. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, Ryan. Thank you so much, Subrajit. Thank you for having me.
So we'll be signing off now, sir.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Subhajit.